Very good morning, everyone. All of you are requested to kindly enter your details in the chat box. Please enter your details in the chat box, UIN, name and the roll number. We'll wait for a minute and then we'll start. Okay, so a very good morning to all of you. Let us start the today's session on cybersecurity and laws. If you remember last time, we had a very interesting session where, if you remember, we had understood what is a social engineering attack. If you remember, it is social engineering involves gathering the secret information as well as the unauthorized access of network. If you remember, we have understood practically where I have told you to fill up the Google form, and some of you had filled up the Google form there. And in that, if you remember, I have asked you to write the details, some of the details for understanding social engineering. And then there was one field which was address, which I've also asked you to fill in. And some of you have filled in thinking that what is the problem in answering the question? What is the problem in writing the address? And that is, I was saying how information gathering is very important, very, very easily possible. I wanted the address. I got an address very easily. And this has to be kept secret with you, but some of you have disclosed it, right? And this is what we do whenever we go to any websites, and if some of the websites do ask us for an information which they are not required to, and if we still give them information, our information is lost. So that is the reason we're always supposed to protect our information and we're not supposed to disclose. But then coming back to the technique, what happens is it gathers the secret information as well as unauthorized access to the network. By the way, if somebody speaks in a way which makes us convincing, and the other person may reveal or other person may know what is there with us or what he wants in, and the information gets revealed. So if you remember, we have seen there were two types of social engineering attack. The first one was a human-based social engineering attack and one was a computer-based attack. And we did both the attacks last time, right? So in human-based attack, we have studied on an impersonating an employer, a valid user. Then we have seen using third party, using calling technical support, shoulder surfing, dumpster diving. And computer, we have seen fake email, email attachment, pop-up windows, and dumpster diving as well. So now going further, we are going to start with a concept on cyber stalking. Now, what is a cyber stalking? How is that crucial? What happens with the cyber stalking? We'll see. Now, when I say cyber stalking, cyber stalking means it is an act or process of following the victim silently. If somebody does an act or process the victim silently, we call it as he's stalking. S-T-A-L-K-N-G. So let me just turn on my PowerPoint so that will be easy and we'll be able to understand it very well. So let me just turn on the screen. Let me just share the PPT. Now let us start with cyber stalking. Now, as I said, stalking means it is an act it's an act or process to follow the victim silently. Okay, So it means it is defined as the use of information, and I can say, or the communication technology, particularly the internet, by an individual or a group of individual to harass another individual or the group or individual or an organization. So it is nothing but a technique where you are actually harassing a person, maybe an individual or maybe a group of individual. Now, what is the reason? It can depend on the reason. But then the main intention is actually to harass someone. So I can say cyber stalking refers to the use of internet or other electronic communication to stalk another person. So if you want to process a victim silently, you can either do it by harassing or threatening. You can do a behavior that the individual will conduct repeatedly, right? So as we all know that internet has now become an integral part of our daily life, maybe a personal life or maybe our professional life. So cyber stalkers take advantage of ease of communication and increase access to personal information with a few mouse click or a few keystrokes, right? So cyber stalkers take an advantage. Now let us understand what are the different types of cyber stalkers, and then we are going to understand what it comes in it. So the first thing that comes is the online stalkers. Now, what is online stalkers? The online stalkers is someone that the aim is to start the interaction with the victim directly over the internet. Now, the main intention of those who are an online stalkers, their main intention is to start the interaction with the victim directly with the help of an internet. Example can be based on email, or the mode of interaction can be a chat room. But then here, the attackers directly talk with the victim, right? Or else this stalker can also make use of a third party to harass the victim. Okay. So these are the things with which an online stalking can be done. It means you are processing the victim or you are following the victim either with the help of an internet where the mode of interaction is direct online. So you can have the mode as email or chat room where you can do a cyber stalking. You also have an offline stalker. Now, what is offline stalker? So these are the stalker may begin the attack by using a traditional method. It means they will try to follow the victim, but maybe by silently, maybe by through an offline way. It means a stalker may attack the victim by observing his daily routine. It means when he moves in, when he moves out of the home, daily routines, plus watching the daily routine of the victim, searching anything about the information of a victim person on a personal website, or visiting the victim organization. So these are the different ways in which this stalking can be done, maybe through an online stalking or maybe through an offline stalking. Online stalking make use of an internet, while offline stalking may be done by observing his daily routine. So let us see what are the case report on cyber stalking. Now, whenever we see about a case report on cyber stalking, you will find out that majority of the cyber stalking women are victim. It means attacker are the men and the victim are the women. It is most of the time found, right? Because there might be some reasons, and that is the reason there might be a cyber stalking may be done against a woman where any man is actually following a victim silently. But then there are very few cases are reported where women are cyber stalking and men are victim. This also possible nowadays, but then there are very few cases where women are cyber stalking and men are the victim, where few cases of the same gender have been identified, right? So it can be done against any woman to a man or a man to a woman, but most of the time it is found that women are the victim and men are always the cyber stalkers who actually follow the woman silently. Now, how stalking is done? So how it is done? First step is that the stalkers first gain the personal information about the victim. It identifies the personal information gathering. And you know nowadays how easy it is to gather the personal information. There are various methods nowadays available for personal information gathering. Maybe we have seen last time how information can be gathered. You can either use social engineering techniques to gather the information, or you might either use the technique of maybe by searching on a website, by searching on an internet, by searching on a LinkedIn profile, Facebook profile, anything. So gaining information is not difficult nowadays. You get it very freely. And there are people who themselves give a lot of information. Where are they? What are they doing? Maybe on a Facebook or maybe on a Twitter or maybe on an Instagram. So personal information gathering is very, very easily available. So first step is to gain the information gathering about a victim. That is to gain the contact number and the address. That is the phone number and the address. First step. Right? Now, once that is done, next step is establish a contact with the victim. Obviously, if you get a personal number of a contact number of a victim, and if you get an address, second step is to start making a friendship or by establishing a contact with a victim. So that can be possible either through a cell phone, maybe a telephone or a cell phone, right? So once you establish a connect with victim through telephone or a cell phone, once the contact is established, the stalker may make call to the victim to threaten or to harass. Now, once the first step is done, once you have gathered information, once you have established a contact with victim, now here comes, now the cyber stalker start their work by calling to victim to threaten. Now there are reason, there are different ways of what are maybe the reason for threatening to a victim. Right? You may tell the victim that I have some photographs of yours. If you do not do this thing, then I will just upload it on a website. I have some of your information about yourself, about your personal life. And if you do not work as per what I say, then I'm going to upload it on a website. So there can be anything. So the only thing is, after you establish the contact with victim, the stalker may call to victim to threaten or to harass. Step number three. The victim almost, or the stalkers almost makes establish a contact with the victim through email. So he may contact by email. The stalker may use multiple emails or the multiple names while contacting the victim. I will give you an example why anyone would do this later on. First, we are going to understand what are the steps involved. So first step is gathering the personal information. Step number two is establishing the contact with the victim. Then continue via email. Point number four next comes is continue sending a threatening mail to victim. Now, cyber stalkers may keep on sending repeated emails asking for various kind of favor or maybe for threatening the victim. So the stalker may say that I may post your personal photo or I may post your information on a website or maybe a porn website. And so the other person might do as per what he says, and this is how the cyber stalkers works. So the stalker may post victim's personal photo or maybe the information after he has gained confidence of a victim, and then he may post it, he may threaten by posting it on a social site or a porn website. So after it is done, the stalkers may post threaten them by posting the victim's personal information on a website, maybe for a dating service or maybe for any other reasons, posing as if the victim has posted the information, and invite the people to call the victim on the given contact details. The stalker will use bad language, or it may use an offensive language, or at the same time, it may use an attractive language to invite the interested person. Right? Now, once he does this, now the cyber stalker will start calling the victim, or he'll share the number of the victim to others who come across the information. For example, the cyber stalkers may post the information about a victim on an internet. That for anything, if you want to do for any sexual relationship, you can either call on this number. The number may be your victim's number. So what will happen is, whomsoever comes across the information, which start calling the victim on the given contact details, and then he will ask for sexual service or maybe a relationship. Right? And it might be possible that some stalkers may subscribe or register the email account of the victim on any pornographic site, because of which the victim will start receiving such kind of an unsolicited emails. So this is how the cyber stalkers can be. So it is always better and always recommended that whatever information we share, probably just make sure whom with whom you are sharing information. So there are cyber stalkers who may misuse information, and the impact can be, an impact can be huge. We do not know, right? So that is how we need to be take care about. So once we have understood cyber stalking, any doubt if you have on cyber stalking, if you're done, we can move towards the next type of cyber crime that's based on cyber cafe. What happens there? But any doubts so far? Okay, thank you, Mohit. Yes. Yes, Vareen, you have a question, I guess. You have raised the hand. Okay, clear. Okay, fine. Okay, superb, very good. Thank you, Vareen. So now, since you have understood what is cyber stalking, let us go to the next slide where we are going to understand about the concept of what happens in a cyber cafe and what are the cyber crime that is done there that we are going to see here. Now, as you all know, that cyber cafe is where the people go and use internet. And in the cyber cafe, probably there are a lot of people who comes up who wants to make use of an internet, maybe for various reasons, maybe for paying bills online, or maybe to mail it to someone, or maybe even for online chatting, or there can be various reasons, right? So, but then cyber cafe is not safe, as we all know. What happens is a cyber cafe can be used also for sending obscene mail to harass the people, because that cannot be easily traced, because a lot of machines and a lot of people comes and sit on a single machine. Even finding it someone is difficult. For example, who had actually made a crime. Plus, cyber crime such as stealing of bank password and subsequent fraudulent withdrawal of money have also happened through cybercrime. Sorry, through cyber cafe. So probably those who are the attacker normally tries to do such kind of a cyber crime on a cyber cafe. The main reason is very easy, that person cannot be easily caught, right? Cyber crime, where then there are a lot of cases. If you search on the internet, you will probably find there are many cases where attack of stealing the bank password, or maybe doing something fraudulent transactions, or maybe withdrawal of money has done from cyber cafe. So as I said, cyber cafe has also been seeing this to harass the people. Now, in an Indian IT Act 2000, now that is an act that gives, as we have seen probably in an introduction chapter, then Indian IT Act probably gives you punishment if you do any crime. So when it comes to this kind of a cyber cafe, so Indian IT Act even 2000 interprets cyber cafe as a network service, which is given in section 79, right? Which imposed on them for due diligence, failing which they would be liable for an offenses committed in the network. So anyone who is caught under the cyber cafe are given a punishment under section 79. So this is nothing to say, but then just for an information that cyber cafe can be. Now, how you're supposed to make yourself protected whenever you are working on a cyber cafe? Now, there are some tips for safety and there are some tips for security while you are making use of a computer in a cyber cafe. First of all, always avoid to go to a cyber cafe. If it is possible for you to log in from your machine, if it is possible for you to log in from your home, from your desktop machine, or maybe from your laptop, then always it is better or always preferable to log in from there instead of going to a cyber cafe, unless it is very urgent or it is unavoidable. Only during certain cases you need to go to cyber cafe, right? Because we do not know on whatever machines are we sitting on, what are the different softwares been there, are the key loggers installed, are there any other mechanisms been there, or maybe some tools might be installed just to capture your ID and password, or it can be various reasons. So first thing is that you need to avoid, but then still if it is unavoidable, then what are the tips for keeping yourself safety and security while using the computer? First thing is, once you're done with your work, always log out. So for example, if you're sending a mail to someone, or maybe you're used for on an online shopping, or maybe you have used it for paying your online bills. If that is unavoidable, do that, but then always log out. We always have a tendency to forget it. Probably you might have noticed many times when you come in your lab and when you access your internet, most of the time happens that if you have a username and password, then you forget it to log out. Even when you access an email, so probably you might be accessing a Moodle maybe for gaining an experiment in the lab, or maybe you might be searching on an email. We forget to log out. Our work is done, we just go away. But then there might be someone who might be sitting next on that machine, and he might be doing something on the another with our identity, because we haven't logged out. So if anything goes wrong, or if anything crime that the person will do will be on your name, because it is authenticated as if you have done a crime. So first thing is always do and always log out. And that is, we have seen again how identity theft can be difficult. Yes, Farin, you can use incognito. That is a good thing that you can do. Yes, very good. That you can always do. Second is stay with the computer. It means when you are working with the computer, you stay with the computer. Do not just stand up and go anywhere. For example, if you're doing some work and suddenly you felt that you want some water, don't just stand up and go away for bringing in the water and then come back. Or maybe for any important work, you might go back. Always you stay with the computer, with the work you're working. Never give chance for anyone to access your machine. Second important point. Third important point, clear the history and temporary file. So probably if you're not using incognito mode, you are supposed to clear your history, and you need to clear the temporary file which is there on the machine. That you need to always do. Fourth step, you need to be alert. When I mean alert, it means you need to make sure that if something is wrong happening, if you are running any of the applications, and if you find out that that machine is either very slow or maybe something on the another is happening with the machine, then protect yourself from, then avoid yourself from doing any further transaction. Stop there itself. Be alert of what you are doing on an internet and what is happening. Fifth point comes is avoid online financial transaction. Very important. Protect yourself from doing online transactions where you are doing an online transaction, such as using your internet. Maybe you might be using it for paying your online bills. Yeah, Anas, any questions? You can just post in the chat box. I can see your raised hand. Okay. No problem. Yeah, no problem, Anas. It's okay. So, as I was saying, you need to avoid any online financial transactions. Try to make sure that you avoid maximum amount of time. All right? Make sure you do that. Now, next point is, always change your password. Wherever possible, you change your password. Do not just keep the same password. So probably if you're using an internet or you might be using in a cyber cafe, so once you are done with it, change your password. That is the best way you can protect yourself. Okay. Change password, as I was suggesting. Next thing you can do is you can make use of a virtual keyboard. Anyone know what is virtual keyboard? Always make use of a virtual keyboard, probably whenever you're doing a transaction on a banking website. Anyone who know what is virtual keyboard, and anyone who have tried what is about a virtual keyboard? And I think most of you, we do not actually make use of a virtual keyboard, but actually we are supposed to do that. Anyone who know what is a virtual keyboard? On-screen keyboard, yes. On-screen keyboard of not your machine, probably. You're somewhat correct, Farin. If you can just explain in detail, on-screen keyboard actually means your own machine's keyboard. That is correct. On-screen keyboard, if you can just explain. Okay, I think, yes, some logging systems have their own keyboard too. True, correct. Yes. Shuffle UI keyboard, correct. Yes, Shubham. Superb. Yeah, Mohit, correct. It allows input of characters without physical key. Now, probably, if you have been to any of the websites, many banking websites, you will see virtual keyboard concept, where it will allow you to enter the key characters not from your physical keyboard, but with the virtual keyboard, which has been there with the website. So that you are only going to click on the characters which is there on the website. So it means, even if somebody has installed a key logger on a machine, or if somebody is just recording your terminal or your keyboard patterns, will not be able to identify because you are not typing anything on a keyboard. So obviously, you will be safe. So always try to make sure you make use of a virtual keyboard. Right? So as I said, virtual keyboard, ICICI Bank provides it to enter secret PIN, your 3D secure code or credit card number. Not only ICICI Bank, nowadays probably every bank, most of the banks provide you with a virtual keyboard. So always make use of a virtual keyboard. Now, virtual keyboard will be more stronger. Probably again, yes, banking websites do have. Yeah, but then what happens is banking websites do provide you with the service, but since because we do not have time and we are always in hurry, we actually tend to forget the security. But then it is always preferable that whenever you're doing anything on a machine, you need to make use of a virtual keyboard so that your keyboard strokes are not being captured. Plus, even there are some websites with review virtual keyboard in which the characters also keeps on changing. So if you turn on the virtual keyboard, the keyboard sequence will not be the way it is in our keyboard. Q, W, E, R, T, Y. It is not the same pattern. It might be pattern might be different. So even if somebody is tracking it, will not come to know what is the actual character we are typing. So yes, always make use of a virtual keyboard wherever possible. Okay. Plus, next thing when you're using on cyber cafe is a security warning. Now, whenever any warning it comes, you need to check. Whenever anywhere if you see there is a security warning, that warning should be considered during any financial transactions. Plus, at the same time, you need to check whether you are transiting on the bank's website and you are not logged in into you are not a victim of a phishing attack. You have not reached to a clone page of ICICIbank.com. Then you need to take care of yourself. You will not click on any hyperlink from an email. If you want to do any financial transactions, you will probably type on a keyboard www.icicibank.com by making sure that you are actually going to the website of icicibank.com and you are not a part of a phishing attack as well. Because it might happen, you might land somewhere else and you may start disclosing any information. Okay? So this was a picture that was taken on 27th June 2009, where of an ICICI Bank website, where they have clearly shown there was a message that was displayed at that time, which I have also included in my slide. In that, if you can see, I have written downstairs that it is showing your cyber cafe security. For that, there was a post being given by an ICICI Bank on their website on 27th June 2009, where they have clearly stated, if you can read it, or else I'll read it for you. They have clearly written on their website, if you're accessing any website, including icicibank.com from a cyber cafe, any shared computer or the computer that other than that of your own, please change your password after such use from your own PC at workplace or at home. So once you do the transaction, you go back home, you change your password from your home's machine or maybe your workplace machine. But just make sure you change your password. It is very important to do so, especially when you have entered your transaction password from such shared computers or cyber cafe computers. Change this password from your own PC at workplace or at a house. So this was an advertisement kind of a thing, or this was a notice that I have mentioned there on the website of an icicibank.com. The main intention was that people should be protected from the attack that had been launched. Right? So there should not be any financial loss of any person. And that is the reason this was a post that was mentioned. And that is why I have added the same on my slide. And then it is always feasible that you will never use probably a financial transaction on a bank's website, on the cyber cafe, unless and until it is very important, very, very important to do so. Otherwise, try always avoiding it. Okay, so this is what I was talking about, a virtual keyboard. So for those who haven't seen what is virtual keyboard, this is a slide which shows you a virtual keyboard. So if you can see on the left hand side, this is the virtual keyboard. So if you go to icicibank.com, probably if you do not know, you can log into icicibank.com and then you can find it, there's a virtual keyboard. If you can see here, for entering passwords only. So just have to click on these characters for the password. Don't use your physical keyboard. But for typing the password, you just press this words here, so that your keyword strokes will not get recorded. So if you can see here, they have also given you some information on it. At ICICIbank.com, at ICICIbank, we are committed to make your banking safe and wonderful experience. Advantage of using virtual keyboard. I'm not reading entirely. I'm just reading what is important. The virtual keyboard is designed to protect your password from malicious spyware or Trojan. Use a virtual keyboard will reduce the risk of password theft. Process to use keyboard. Steps to use the keyboard. Enter login ID using physical keyboard. Select the checkbox, use virtual keyboard. Use the virtual keyboard. And once you have entered the password, click on login. So very well they have mentioned. And this was again given on 27th June 2009 on the website of ICICIbank.com. So this was entirely about the virtual keyboard, and this was entirely about the cyber cafe. Next slide, we are going to start with a concept on botnet. Now, what is botnet and what does the bot do that we are going to see it? Before that, we have 5 minutes left probably. Those who haven't entered their details or joined late are requested to kindly enter your details in the chat box, your UID, your name and the roll number. Please do not forget it to enter your details, otherwise your attendance will not get counted. So make sure you enter your details first, and then we'll starting with it. Once the session gets over, I'll be starting with a botnet. I'm not sure whether I'll be able to complete the same or not. If in case we are done with it, you can join back in the next session, probably after 5 minutes. Any doubts so far? Clear so far? If yes, we'll proceed to the botnet. Anyone has any doubt? Okay, thank you, Nausin. Yes, thank you for the update. Now, let us start with the concept of a botnet. What is a bot? Anyone who knows what is a bot? Have you ever heard the concept of BOT? We'll understand what is a bot, then we'll concentrate on a botnet. Have you ever heard the name bot? No one? Okay, no problem. Khalid, the software robot. Yes, you can say that way. Yes. Actually, bot is nothing but an automated program. Bot is nothing but an automated program which is responsible for performing specific tasks over the network. So it is an automated program which does most of the work. Something AI related, you can say that way. But then it is an automated program where main task is which is responsible to perform specific tasks on a computer, right? So when I say specific task, the task can vary. Now what are the different tasks a bot can do, we'll see. But then bot is nothing but an automated program that has been there to do a specific task over the network. Now, probably there might be a bot that might do an automated task of creating an account, fake account. You might have an automated program that keeps on creating an account on a Google. You can do that. Or you might have a bot that might create a lot of fake emails. And that is the reason, if you remember, at most of the websites, they ask you to enter the CAPTCHA, if you remember, right? They ask you that you enter the CAPTCHA so that no computer program can actually understand what the users have to do. And it is a way to identify or differentiate between a user and computer support. So that is why the CAPTCHA has came into, because you want to protect yourself from a bot which are responsible for performing specific tasks over a network. So then once you understood what is a bot, bot is nothing but an automated program that keeps on doing it. So also plus at the same time, there can be a bot that can be used in a share market that may keep on purchasing or they may keep on selling the stock or vice versa, something like that. So it's nothing but an automatic program which is responsible to perform specific tasks. So what is a botnet? Botnet is nothing but a group of infected computer or is a network of a computer, a network of infected computer that allows attacker to control the machine remotely. I'll repeat again. Botnet is a network of infected computer that allows attacker to control the machine remotely. So I can say botnet is nothing but a zombie network where other machine has turned zombie. We have seen what is a zombie earlier, right? So a botnet is nothing but a zombie network with a network of infected computers where you have a malicious program that allows the cyber criminal to control the infected machines remotely. So you have all the machines which has now turned zombie because of a malicious program and through which they can actually communicate or they can control the infected machines. We call it as a botnet. So botnet is nothing but a network of computers which is infected with a malicious program. And once they are infected with a malicious program, then attacker can take a control of an attack and then he can launch an attack such as denial of service attack or distributed denial of service attack. Right? So there are various ways. A person might have a program or it might make a network of computers infected, maybe through a Trojan or maybe through a viruses or maybe to any malicious program. And then he can use it once the victim has turned a zombie, he can then use the zombie machine to launch an attack. Okay. And it is always possible, even if your computer systems may be a part of a botnet, even though it appears to be an operating normally. So there is no symptom that your machine is infected with a botnet or not. Or is it a part of the botnet or not? It is possible that your computer may be a part of a botnet, but then it might appear normally. So I think we have left 10 minutes left. We'll stop it here. You can all join back after 5 minutes. And we'll continue again with botnet. Thank you so much. Requested to kindly enter the details. They have not done yet. Last minute left. 1 minute left. Okay, thank you for joining in. We'll meet again in the next session.